Good morning and welcome to our webcast. I'm Samir Mehta, your moderator. This is session number 67, the first one in the new year. And let me begin by wishing all our viewers a very happy new year. We have a complex coronary intervention involving distal left main. You'll also watch imaging modalities with OCT, and hopefully this will initiate a beginning of an excellent year for us. Sameen, good morning to you.
Yes, good morning, and from our cath lab, and clearly we welcome all our viewers
slight,
for 2015.
Slight delay in the patient reaching today.
Yes. Yeah, it's just happened too, so that we, sorry for to our viewers who are online for last 10, 12 minutes, but we are all set to start.
Sameen, I want to congratulate you and your team on having achieved an excellent year. I have just received some data of the hospital's appropriateness criteria, the volume and the complications, and on all these three counts, your hospital is ranked number one in the state.
Yes, that is correct. And this goes to our old tradition of our teamwork and everyone helping out and go through the protocol. Set particularly in complex cases continues to have this consistent outcome, and knowing that we are a little delayed today, so I think we just go quickly to start our this particular case, because there was some discussion, and particularly more we really want to emphasize the technique for distal left main bifurcation lesion. Now if it's okay, we start with our supporters as shown here. Disclosure, there is no difference, same, and as you mentioned, this case number 67 is an 83-year-old female who had angina for many years, stable, had a cath actually in 2009, where had showed left main and moderate disease of other vessels, was recommended surgery versus medical therapy. She did well until recently started having class 3 angina and dyspnea. She did not have any stress testing, because knowing that she had a disease before, and of course we'll show you that we found this left main disease with normal ejection fraction. She's on good medical therapy, which is shown here, and she very hyperlipidemia, both triglycerides and so. So she's on combined therapy for that purpose, and she may require some non-cardiac surgery. This is the disease, basically distal left main, which is bifurcating into the LED and circumflex with a non-obstructive RCA, syntax score 24, EF normal, and the question is, what to do for this distal left main bifurcation. This is what we'll use some technology of the OCT, rotational atherectomy, and plant to stent approach. Now, with a 24 syntax, and I'll come back in my discussion, that just because of complexity of the left main, it's reasonable to have a heart team discussion, which did, and patient obviously had been reluctant for CABG, whether it was recommended very well earlier or not. They're clearly here. She had a discussion with the surgeon and elected for PCI, which although put into OCT criteria, but more important is for multi-vessel left main CAD grid. And here will fit into the class just one before the bottom. That is the left main stenosis with additional CAD with low CAD burden, defined as a syntax score of less than 33. So this patient will fall into that category, so that PCI will be U. And only inappropriate, as we know, is the patients who are high syntax burden and left main disease and who are low surgical risk, go for the clearly a class 3 indication for our ACC. With that note, Anu has taken a baseline shot so that we can show that. Anu?
Yes, if you see the LV, her EDP was about 20. She has a normal LV gram, and also very important, calcium. I think, to see is on the LV gram, she has a tram track calcium. From distal left vein extending into the circ and also into the LAD. She has a non-obstructive right coronary artery, and this is where her left vein. You have a distal left vein, 90 to 95 into LAD and circumflex. Both are large size vessel. In the caudal, maybe a moderate 50-60 in the mid LAD, which we don't appreciate in the cranial view. But there is a diag which is the bifurcating LAD diag, which has a disease free. So essentially, we are talking about calcific distal bifurcating distal left main.
Yeah. Anu, the biggest concern here would be the ostium of the circumflex, of course.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
I think if in this view actually, if you see right here.
Yeah.
90 to 95. The question is, you know, based on the amount of calcium, we definitely want to do atherectomy. You know, which the question always comes, how do we approach this? Do we have to, by imaging modality, just to see the amount of calcium and then pick the atherectomy of choice? We have to do atherectomy of both the vessels. And how we are going to do it is the one that we're going to show.
Anu, what about any support device here, a balloon pump, impeller?
That's a good question. Since EF is normal in this kind of a case, likely despite it is distal left main involving two major vessels, I think we should be able to do it without any support.
Excellent.
And I think that's a very important point in our algorithm also. That if you have more extensive disease, knowing that this is more of a trifurcation, just focal, very extensive, you require multiple work with the rotablation and of course there is associated moderate to severe LV dysfunction. Support device will come in. Here, would we need it? It may be, but I think majority of the cases we learn should be able to do it without any adjunct support.
But in an abundance of caution, somebody having a small 5 French access from the left groin would be acceptable?
Well, I mean, yes. If many people will put just a sheath, 5 French sheath, and so that rapidly it can be upgraded to the balloon pump if needed. So with that note, what you plan to do in this particular case?
I think one thing that you definitely need with this case, elderly patient, you're doing rotational atherectomy of the left main, though her leakage is normal, that you definitely need a temporary pacemaker in this particular case. And to understand the extent of the calcium, I think we have decided that we will do OCT. So it's very important. I think we can show it, we'll show it online how to do the OCT, since we have this new acquisition which will show both the angiography as well as the OCT being done at the same time.
And the question is, do you need to do in both the limbs or just one limb suffice?
Look, the way the vessel looks like, it will probably will be able to do only LAD.
Okay.
Even that may be questionable. If the disease is more than 90%, once we have the OCT catheter across and we give some dye, if you don't see any dye flowing through the vessel distally, it's not safe to do the OCT.
Right.
Okay. So while they're getting a knowing that now, what about the burst size? Once you decide it's a heavily calcified, which is angiographically looks that way,
I think we are going to burr both LAD and CERC. We'll definitely do start with 175 burr. I think doing atherectomy of more of the circumflex more than 175 with that angle may be questionable. If 175 burr still does not look like we have done a lot of atherectomy, we do have a 8 French guide if we have to upsize the burr to 2.15.
Okay, I think that's a good plan. So while I go through my issues involving the case, Anu will get ready with the guide catheter and OCT. As soon as they are ready for the OCT, we'll come back live. And you selected a 8 French VL4 mark guide, very soft tip with a good VL 3.5 mark. And clearly, many times you can go with the JL, but once you have that angulated or FL. With that angulated guide, angulated circumflex, maybe a tough to deliver the stent. Now, many people say, well, why do you need to do atherectomy? Even if there is a calcium, we can use a high pressure, or a short lesion, and use a maybe cutting balloon or flexome or angiosculp. Reason is that it's a heavily calcium. And in my opinion, that yes, you can put a stent, but have a true expansion of the stent will be determined by degree of calcium. So as long as you can take that calcific cap out by doing atherectomy, even with a moderate atherectomy, you don't have to go to a big bar of 2.25 or so, that will be good enough. So we'll talk about two things. One is update on unprotected left main PCI, and second is the latest paper in JACC about the risk of non-cardiac surgery after coronary stenting. Now, unprotected left main, as we know, the big issue remains whether it's an osteolar shaft versus distal bifurcation, which is majority of the cases. And that's where the outcomes of the left main definitely dependent are different if the lesion is ostial mid-shaft versus distal. And like this case, majority of our left mains are distal. Now, we remember the Syntex trial, the paper published last year about the five-year follow-up of the Syntex. Basically, if you take the CABG group, that overall, except the revascularization, higher in the PCI group, that clearly, and of course, the MI, the CV and other way, but truly there was no difference in the death. That's an important point over the 5 year for the left main patients. But now if you go to individual risk group, and this is a very elegantly shown by overall cohort of this 5 year left main, 5 year total MECI in the Syntex trial, overall, then left main and three vessel. Now you see that once you go to a different tertile, particularly for the less than 22, 23 to 32, which is the left and middle graphs, in the left main they are exactly identical in terms of the PCI and CABG. But clearly that of course the difference occurs when you are more than 32, which is the right side. But if you go to three vessel disease, you can see the superiority of the CABG even in the low risk group, although numerically lower, but more importantly it differentiate with a Syntex of 22 and above. So very important that for the three vessel disease, clearly the Syntex has a more implication even with the intermediate risk group of 23 to 32, while in the left main only it comes into equation with a 33 and above. Now then, since there were CABG has a kind of identical outcome, yeah, keep going. Yeah, OCT, yes. Yeah. You continue your OCT and as soon as you are ready, you tell us and we'll come. Then how can you differentiate this further? Because Syntex basically on the CABG had a similar outcome. So we know that Syntex is anatomic, but what happens to the patient on the long term in terms of mortality and so is all dependent on the many other characteristics. And these are the Syntex then came up with a clinical Syntex score, ACFE, and more importantly, Syntex score 2. Which use the 8 parameters, age, creatinine clearance, LVEF, presence of unprotected left main, peripheral vascular disease, female sex, and COPD. So taken that those all together, they came up with a new classification because each of these parameters had their interaction and predictive value to discriminate CABG versus PCI. The idea was that can you discriminate particularly for the mortality for the CABG versus PCI, knowing that the CABG has identical outcome based on the Syntex MECI. And this actually had now have been put into our various publications, the one report of the 1500 patients to say the Syntex score 2 derived whether it's a low tertile, the intermediate or high tertile, 21, 28 and above, that clearly there is a difference in three tertile in terms of the myocardial infarction, all-cause death and ischemia-driven TVR was not different, but key is the more important difference in the death and MI, and if you put together the MACI, clearly there is a separation. So that really adds to the Syntex score 2 taken clinical accounting or clinical features really adds to Syntex score in terms of prediction of the event rate and particularly the mortality. Now then the other question which has come, what else can we predict? Particularly with the bifurcation lesion, there has been a lot has been written that bifurcation angle pre and post PCI, whether it's a proximal bifurcation or distal bifurcation. The distal bifurcation between left LAD and circumflex is more important, and that has been studied in some papers, yes, some papers, no. But more importantly, now they have come up with a new parameter called systolic diastolic range, SDR, in the 3D reconstruction, which is defined as absolute difference between diastolic and systolic distal bifurcation angle value of less than 10 and more than 10. What does that mean? Less than 10 means the vessel is so stiff, it is not moving during systole and diastole. More than 10 means the distal bifurcation lesion moves separate more than 10 degrees and so. And what is it has shown that if you take only the distal bifurcation angle, there is of the various angles, no correlation with the outcome. But if you take the systolic diastolic range, that whether it's a 10 degree or more than 10 degree, you see the curve separation, whether it's a one stent or more than one stent. So very, very important observation, which we learned for the left main, whether it need to be subsequently substantiated by other publications, we need to see. Also, we know that Delta registry have shown that overall PCI and CABG, the outcome, except the TVR definitely is higher. Now then, within the delta registry, if you take only the ostial and left main, basically seems to be identical outcome. So key is, again, it's a proximal and ostial and sheft left main has a better outcome, similar to CABG. Now what do you do approach? Large vessel like this particular case, which has a large left main, has involvement of circumflex as well as LAD, there are various techniques. Whether you use a V stenting or SKS, which is two stent approach, or DK crush or culotte, anything will be viable in this particular case. And if the circumflex is small and not diseased, single stent crossover, irrespective of the left main size, is the right approach. And DK crush 3 for the left main has shown superiority of the DK crush over the culotte technique. So this comes back to the original graph which I showed, that this is where we are. And of course, the European guidelines are a little more lax, that there is no class 3 indication of the left main at present, irrespective of the syntax score. But we clearly, in the ACC guidelines, syntax score of 32 and above, patient with the left main is still class 3 indication. And then of course, the two trials ongoing, one completed, which is Excel and Noble, which is using biometrics, and Excel using the everolimus eluting stent, will answer this question of a CABG versus a PCI superiority in selected patients. Now, Anu, you are ready now, tell us.
Run through wire across the LAD.
Okay.
And I'm just going to go across the left main, no problem. So there are two markers, three actually. So the distal, the optic light is actually at the middle marker, if you can see it. I'm just going to go sine. So you have the distal marker, which is nothing. The middle marker is where your light is, and then you have the proximal marker, which is already in the guide. You can see that now?
Yes, very nicely.
Good. And now when we inject, where is it? Oh, yeah. You can see? Yeah, that's good. So everything is, I cannot pull this closer.
And you are going to show the co-registration of the angiogram as well as the OCT?
Yeah. So first I do sine. Enable, and then you can inject.
Take the guide off.
That's good.
Beautiful illustration, Anu.
Now see this, it's a beautiful system.
Fantastic.
Have a co-registration of both angiogram and OCT. Keep it for a few minutes.
So you have to mark the distal and the proximal marker. And then, it's registered, okay?
Okay, tell us what we are seeing and what are you showing us?
Okay, now you see the co-registry. Oh, you know what, it did not, it too, went into the circumflex.
Okay.
And undo the co-registration and redo it.
Yeah.
It went up.
Right.
I think you have to put three markers. Yeah, and now you put the, now it's better. Yeah. Let it play. It takes a little while for the co-registration to happen. Yeah, now you can see it. Oh, the O is still going. It's okay, just show the OCT. Just the by the distal left main. Yeah, right there. It's going up. Mm-hmm. Go to the distal left main. That's okay, right there. Yeah, that's the smallest, right? Not too much calcium. In the LED. Yeah. Most of the calcium is in the LED, not so much in the distal left main. Just show the distal left main there. You cannot do the co-registration. Huh? Can you do it again? Yeah. Yeah, that's the distal mark. Middle, there, there. Can you take it down?
Can we see distally at the ostium of the circumflex also? How bad is the...
Actually, distal left main does not have a lot of calcium, surprisingly. Most of it is in the LAD. Yeah. Just show the OCT. Actually, if you have the co-registration for some reason, it starts with LAD and then when it reaches the distal left main going into the circ, the marker. So if you can see the OCT right now.
I think we avoid the co-registration, we just go
yeah,
with
yeah.
The...
Now we're just going to show the OCT. Now we are coming to the distal left main, you can see it there. Keep coming. No, it's coming to the distal left main. Stop it here. So if you see, this is the LAD. So far you can see the marker in the angiography, if you see the sinec, and all that is calcium, almost four quadrants, right?
Yeah.
And now, as you come to the distal left main, it's not a lot of calcium, more of fibrous tissue. And this is... Yeah.
Anu, based on what you are seeing on OCT, does that modify your approach?
No.
Okay.
Because even though the distal left main does not show it, just at the ostium of the LAD, if you see here.
Yeah, there's a lot of calcification.
So all this is calcium.
Yeah. Okay.
And since our stent is going to extend right here. Stent is going to extend into the ostial LAD to prox LAD. You're doing the LAD now?
No, sir.
Where are you?
Sir, LAD near bigger one. Okay, so now while we are getting ready for our rota, clearly identified with the new technology, we go to quickly the next point, and while we are getting ready for performing the rotational atherectomy. Now, this particular case, second point was the non-cardiac surgery after coronary stenting. You know, the major paper in JAMA a few years ago, actually Tom Maddox, who is the senior author, was Sinai fellow about 6 years ago from the VA study, and basically showed that there is a linear relationship when the surgery is done in these patients after stent procedure, irrespective of the bare metal or the DES. That is the time interval, and they followed the patients for 30-day outcome, that what happens when you have a stent placed within 24 months. And clearly, as you can see, the cutoff basically is at 6 months. So after 6 months, there is a significant reduction in the event rate. And this is extension of the same paper from the authors' same database that came up with that really identify which patient gets into trouble. And they basically had a 61,000 plus cases underwent stenting and compared those who had a non-cardiac surgery compared to those who did not have non-cardiac surgery in 1-to-2 ratio. And then they followed these patients for the 30-day outcome and basically showed that anytime you have non-cardiac surgery, your event rate is high. But more importantly, that all patients and then stent and surgery versus stent only. If you can see that MACE rate is much higher when you have a surgery in the stent patients of a 30-day, if you take all patients together, which we know. We all know that patients who had stent, they go for non-cardiac surgery, they have a higher event rate if they don't have the surgery, stent only is the shown in the MACE, MI, there is no difference in revascularization as we expect, and the mortality. So almost 1% difference, higher event rate, patients who have stent and going for surgery versus if they would have been without surgery cohort. Now, this is again very important, and just to emphasize bare metal versus DES, the DES in the middle, bare metal on the right, that as you can see, that at 6 month interval, that 6 month really is the cutoff of the event rate. So after that, the curve flattens for both bare metal and the DES. So 6 months kind of is the key factor which determine the subsequent outcome. And you can see if you put it together, 6 weeks, 6 weeks to 6 months, and to more than 6 months. Now, clearly 6 weeks, absolute contraindication. Unless patient has a dying hemodynamically or surgery required for urgent life-saving, less than six weeks. 6 to 6 months in between, but clearly after 6 months, you really decrease all MACE event rate, very, very important as shown here. And this actually leads to that which surgery, which or the cardiac condition or clinical condition of the patient really important. Now clearly as overall the DES has a more event rate compared to bare metal. Surgery type, if you have any time you do a peritoneal cavity, our old data, those Goldman's rule, that clearly once you open the belly, you have a higher event rate. So the difference of the event within 6 months and less than 6 months and more than 6 months really gets into DES, digestive versus inpatient versus outpatient. Outpatient have a lower event rate than high risk surgery and more complex surgery requiring high RVUs, means it's a more complex surgery, which is put in a nice illustration here that inpatient elective patients who have high, the complex surgeries, they really have a higher event rate. There is a much curve separation. Elective patient, ambulatory, simple surgery, I think you can do it within 6 weeks and 8 weeks or 12 weeks. But clearly difference comes only in the more complex cases that you have to defer for 6 months. Now this goes or support our data. We have the 5,000 patient Zions V USA registry, which showed that overall is in the red and standard mean low risk cases, that clearly your risk goes down or eliminates after 6 months. And of course, in the lower one, we have standard risk, means low risk, even 1 or 3 months can be done. So clearly we have consistent data now, the 6 months time period, which kind of give protection for these patients. And these actually have been incorporated in the guidelines of the 2014 ACCHA guideline of non-cardiac surgery, where the cardiac catheterization actually is a very, very last in terms of risk stratification, mostly done by clinical as well as non-invasive workup, as shown here. The routine cardiac catheterization for periop evaluation is class 3, so should not be done routinely. And of course, the perioperative therapy, that when we should stop antiplatelet therapy, is shown here. And key is the elective versus stable, and the whole issue about 1 month and 12 months, to me, I think based on the latest data, it should be 6 months. So clearly, whether DES or BMS, you try to postpone surgery for 6 months, and after 6 months, it will be okay. So, and that goes to also our 6 month short duration of the DAP, which we are coming. People do ask, what about in many of these cases who need urgent surgery, can we use a glycoprotein 2B3 inhibitor? This is one study where they give a IV a 2B3 inhibitor for 6-7 days, and they were associated with significant bleeding. So that's not the answer. So coming back to the point, that unless it's a life-threatening emergency surgery and or just an elective surgery, ambulatory elective surgery, the surgery should be postponed for 6 months because of various changes which occurs during surgery with the catecholamines, the high clotting factors and so, coagulation cascade, that those patients are at higher risk of developing stent related events. And we are ready here. Meanwhile, so what we did is, we were knowing that the circumflex was the much tighter, we did already, yeah, let's go. Yeah, the circ was the much tighter, we have put a wire into the circumflex and we are with the 1.75 bar for the circ. So I think the LAD, to me, we can use a bigger bar because 1.75 may be just a too small. We have 8 French guide and we can have a 2.15 bar if required for the LAD. And this will give us some rule also that how much resistance we get when we do the burring with this, with the 1.75 into the circumflex. Okay, talk about this, what you're planning to do now.
Yeah, I think in this situation, good, same. If you're going to do the distal left main to circ, you either start burring from the guide itself, or since here the left main is long, we can start at the ostium of the left main. So we did our 3 steps and now we just start burring, slow burring, same, coming out of the guide, getting into the left main now.
And hold the guide with the left hand, edge, make sure we show her left hand.
Sine?
Yeah, with the... It should be closer, yeah. The key is that hold the guide because burr will not make a turn. Every time you go, it's going to push it back. Yeah.
Now the patient is needing pacemaker. This is the key point, that you go very slow. Should we give a little atropine? And every time she's using the pacemaker, you know, the pressure drops. So in that situation, you don't give neosinephrine. You actually have to give atropine so they get that atrial kick back and the blood pressure will automatically go up.
And time to time, we just flush also, little dye and more of a flush to move the contrast and so, yeah.
So Anu, you normally use a milligram of atropine?
Now we are done, and we are going to come out now. The question is, do you come out completely?
Yeah, I have to go with the same bar into the LED,
yeah.
Right?
And the different bar. I think the 1.25, okay. Yeah, our plan was that 1.75 bar may be a little too small, but with the angulated, I think it's nothing different. I mean, no harm done. And we are going to take a picture now. Reason is that you basically worry about in the angle, that a bigger bar will create a gutter effect. So we'll see how things are, and then we decide whether we go with the same bar or we go with a 2.15 bar or a 2.20 bar. I think this is a good, reasonable outcome. Has done, there is this ostial, although there is still there. Do you want to use a bigger bar here?
Circ?
Yeah.
No.
Huh? But there's a lot of calcium junk.
I know your concern was mainly the angle when Sameen asked about a bigger bulk for the circ.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. But always the question is the same. When you're doing bifurcation left main,
right,
the eculus, the issue is always the ostial circ. You never get a good expansion of the ostial circ. And usually if the restenosis happens, is always of the ostial circ.
Prior to stenting, would you consider even using a cutting balloon there?
We have actually a cutting balloon, yeah, opened for a, yeah, circumflex.
At the adjunct.
Yeah.
Adjunct, which we call rota cut. Now we have to change the wire if you go to the LED, right?
No, this is...
2.15 bar.
So not the circ?
No, question is, do we need to do 2.15? I think we can go.
I think it'll cut the vessel. See that? Already, yeah, has some wire bias, no? I think it's okay. Based on that, since it was not... maybe it's more... Okay. So we change the wire...
To the LED now.
Anu, why not make a pass with the 1.75 and then decide if you want to go?
I think what we'll do is, let's do the LED with the 1.7, the 2.15 bar, and then if necessary in the end, while guide is the bar is still in the guide catheter, we may decide to go back in the circ also.
All right.
Good.
Then I'm in the diag.
Yep. Okay. We need to do a very proximal segment anyway. That's okay. We need just a small room, and many times, you know, we put too much effort putting the wire distally. As long as it's in the major vessel, and we are not going beyond the ostial LED, that's okay. Rather than putting the wire multiple times into different areas. I think we may end up in putting using this 2.15 for the circ also.
Mm-hmm.
And as the key is very important when you're working with a 2.15 bar, you need an 8 French guide. The 7 French will take 2.0 bar, will not take a 2.15. 8 French guide, you can use a 2.15 and 2.25 bar.
The reference vessel caliber for the left main was about 4.25 or something?
The left main is almost 5.5. 5.5, yeah, okay. 5.5 to 6. So that will come back to the point.
Some interesting issues, yeah, what stent to use.
Yes. As we plan that this kind of a case, we'll have a planned two-stent approach. Good. So same, about 150 outside speed. And then we go slowly with the push and pull. That one is still remain the issue, the wire. That wire is a little more user-friendly, but at the same time, this is a flimsy wire.
Well, you've only said that for the last 6 years.
Yes.
Nobody is listening.
Yeah.
All right.
Clearly, nobody wants to, but I can tell you now it's going to change, as of this year. Yeah. Because there is a separate DRG now for this complex endovascular the group 3. And this is going to change because of the say, you know, different reimbursement scheme. That clearly when you do this complex case, there is a hospital will not lose money. And the Boston Scientific as well as orbital atherectomy people are concentrating that how to increase the...
So once again, steadying the guiding catheter with the left hand there?
Yes.
Okay.
So just outside and hold, keep holding the guide.
Now even with the 2.15, less challenging to do the LAD.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, we thought so.
Yeah.
The 2.15, because it's a very big vessel.
Right.
And the tighter lesion was in the circumflex than LAD. LAD was like 60-70, but clearly it was an 80% lesion in the ostial circle.
Anu, did the patient pace during
yes.
the...
Yeah.
He did, okay.
Yeah. More polyphenols come
out. So did you give more atropine?
Pacing now.
No atropine.
No atropine.
Okay.
Yeah. But as soon as you stop, good.
One of the questions I wanted to ask you about OCT, how did the patient tolerate?
How did?
The how did?
OCT was no issue, no? She tolerated?
No, no, no,
okay.
No. You see that when you test, you should be able to see the vessel, which we saw. If we not, then we should not
right.
do the OCT.
Right.
You want to go to the circle? No, right?
Yeah, but not it. We'll see. Come out. This wire will not go this way.
Sameen, in your estimation and experience, how does the OCT compare with IVUS regarding calcification?
Yeah, I think we are just trying to learn on the OCT parameters, although it has a little more better delineation, but knowing that the calcium, we have learned quite a bit on IVUS because there's always a comes the whether it's clearly demarcated versus not demarcated. If clearly demarcated becomes more calcium, not demarcated is your you know, the more of a lipid-rich plaque, and so that issue always remains. So I think those OCT believers will say that we have a better visualization, they can quantify the calcific nodule and so forth, but those IVUS will not quantify except the arc, because the calcium is, you know, refractory and you don't see anything behind. So now let's take a picture, and then we decide whether we need to do the circumflex or not. Without 2.15 bar. Ready?
Okay.
We can use with the 3.5 or 4-0 flexstone both sides.
We actually opened a 3.5 angioscope.
Okay, that we can use for the sub. No, but let's wire first. No, but important decision need to be made now. At this time,
2.15 bar off the circ.
2.15 bar for the circ.
No.
Okay. This is fine. Go. So that's okay because we learned that as long as you have taken away that calcium, this will be all right. That your stent subsequently will expand. So now we have two wires. One is the run through.
Let's see where it will go.
Yeah. You put a run through in the. Circumflex, and you need more support in the circumflex. Good.
Sameen, enormous implication of the second topic you discussed about the non-cardiac surgery.
Yes, they are very important. I mean,
very important.
Lead article with the.
And also because it eliminates the doubt, you know, whether it would be safer after a bare metal stent.
Right. And I think what has been the word that bare metal may be safer, we learned even in the depth study, actually the bare metal has a little higher event rate than the DES.
Right.
So it's not that bare metal is benign. It's the time interval. The key is
six months.
Type of surgery
six months.
The time interval. Yes.
Right.
Simple ambulatory. Straightforward surgery with the, I don't know whether the laparoscopy gallbladder removal will come into that, but simple hernia surgery and some amputation or some, those simple surgeries are completely fine. But once you get to the more complex, high RVU surgeries and opening the digestive, you know, involving the GI tract, those are the patients will require you will have a bigger difference in terms of event rate. So clearly you need to be more careful. Good. Yeah. You want to open the LED first or circ first?
I think let's do the circ first.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
If it doesn't open, then you have to do the...
Yep.
215 then, yeah.
Then we can take a 4-0 flexstone for the LED. Because the LED is very big vessel, so
right.
Now, knowing that the circ may require a little higher pressure, knowing that the angiosculpt you can go up to 16 if required, while the flexstone you cannot go beyond 12, chances of rupture are much higher, so that we are modifying the technique. So it's a combined technique of just not using the bigger rotational technique, it's just a combination of both.
High pressure balloon.
Yeah.
Well, went easily.
So this is fine. This is fine. 16. Yeah. You don't need a 4-0 balloon. If
no,
it's expanded.
High pressure.
Yeah, but we don't need now.
No,
maybe post.
LED. Yeah. No need to cut. Why don't you use a high pressure balloon?
Okay. What length we have?
4-0-15. Are you already opened?
Yeah. Then good. We have the 4-0 flexstone. Good. Come back a little bit. Yeah. Here. At this level. Good. Nice opening.
So the ease with which it expanded gives you a feeling that rotational ablation was adequate?
Right. Yes. Yeah. Exactly. I mean, the key is that you just have to break that
the
calcific
right.
arc.
Right.
And that is what the whole issue is. That just as you and I have broken even at one level, see?
Excellent. Looks
open
very,
nice.
Yeah.
Is it 4-0 for that lady?
Yeah.
Okay, so 2 4-0s. What's stent?
So SKS strategy here?
Yeah, this is our plan, that to plan 2 stent approach. Okay. Yeah, actually inadvertently, while we are removing so many things from the table, the wire was pulled back. Put the circ wire first.
LED does never go into the LED.
That's fine. Yeah, that's okay. That's fine. Little die.
Yeah, it's going to the one.
Good. Okay.
All right. You need more stability with the circ wire.
Need a high pressure 4-0 first to dilate both of them.
Then we don't need flex stone.
Sure. Yeah. So let's open. So this is now 4-0. Our quantum. Quantum apex. So we're trying to open both the lesions because we need to really expand before we get into. And we are going to do LED and then the circ. Yeah, okay. People ask that, do you need to do a kissing balloon inflation? No, they're not necessary. That even if there's some plaque shift occurs, that's okay. You are going to put a stent there anyway.
But absolutely mandatory after placing 2 stents.
And after the 2 stents, if you're using a different technique. Now, if you're using a simultaneous kissing stent or V-stenting like kind of this case, you probably don't need any different. Because they now, if the carina has not expanded, then yes. And the vessel size distal is about 6 millimeter left main, so we can have a 3.5 or 4-0 in each branch. So the combined will be 2/3 of the 7 or 8 millimeter, so that it will can accommodate 3.5 or 4-0, whatever our clinical decision will be.
What stent you want?
The stent size. Okay, let's go to the circ.
4-0
I think
18?
We should open circ again. Yeah. Yeah, we can take both 2 4-0-18. Or you can take a 4-0-15.
I don't think we have 15s.
No, but there's 2 4-0-18s will be good.
Which stent are you planning to use?
The Zions.
Okay.
2 4-0-18.
Sameen, does the institution get a lot of unprotected left main cases referred?
Yeah, we actually are same. Like this case was knowing that had a known disease and so came to us, had an angiogram done somewhere outside, but then they knew that it will require likely the PCI and patient was reluctant and came for this purpose. So that we, I would say that every month for the same purpose that we end up in doing, now stent has been fully expanded. So about of our 325
just
PCIs,
as
about 25 to 30 will be about 8-9% unprotected left main.
Just to advance further learning and education, do some of the physicians who are referring these patients also sometimes come and watch the procedure?
Like, yes, sometimes. And then definitely they want to have a
2-4-0-18s. Yeah,
that they definitely want to have the disc back so that they can also see at their leisure.
Ever get some of these patients referred from outside the country?
Not the left main, because I think once you have the left main, unprotected left main, those kind of cases, knowing what the setup there is, and so I would say knowing that there is a restenosis and based on what could be availability of the resources. So our threshold is a little different, somebody who's coming internationally. So knowing that this, no matter what you do, what technique it is, still there is a higher TLR with a PCI. There may not be difference in the death, MI or stent thrombosis, but definitely higher TLR with the PCI, no matter what DES we use. So in the, having said that, so in those cases, those who are international, I try to send them for CABG, unless it is CABG is contraindicated because of bad COPD or CVA. Like this case, you know, it's just reluctance is different, but this case I would say will easily can be sent or convinced if they're coming internationally for that region, that should go for CABG. So just coming back to the point
four,
that...
4-5-15 high pressure.
So we have to go for circ 4-5. Yeah. That now we have put one already into the circ. Therefore, you put a first stent of the kissing into the area where you feel will be more difficult, angulated, so that will be the circumflex. And now...
Post OCT.
Okay. So now we are okay. We're good. Good position. Okay. We're taking a picture. Proximal marker identical. Yep.
Excellent positioning.
Going a little bit.
You want to go? Okay. Good. That's fine. So kind of, you know, if we less than like 2-3 millimeter, trying to make it a V, but this will be definitely.
Again,
does
you
it look now?
You pull both of them together at least for a few more millimeters.
I think you're okay now.
No.
Isn't it?
That's fine.
Okay.
We're taking one more picture. So, this by definition will become like a
V.
Clearly V or a small, not a capital S, S care, a small S. Okay. Now, once we are ready, we go both quickly, go at 10 atmosphere or 12. 12, and then simultaneous deflation, so both inflation and deflation. Now individually we'll go up our whatever usual is 16 atmosphere. So this is the part 2, this is the circumflex, I'm going 16. The balloon of the LED keeps it there from being crushed, so it's deflated. So now you come out, there's still a little dent at the ostial circ which may require a big bigger balloon. So now we deflate, now you go to the LED. My fellow here, Shiny, will go again. While deflated balloon remains in the circumflex, go to 16 atmosphere. Good. Negative. This is the step 3.
Always now, watch the blood pressure. Yes. Our blood pressure actually has been at 120. If there is a drop in blood pressure, there's a time you need to make sure that you have to have a neo given even before the inflation.
Yep.
If it goes sometime, you know, certain cases it can go really low, 80 or so. In that situation, you may have to wait a little while till the blood pressure picks up again.
So, I mean,
triple digit.
Simultaneously, how many atmospheres did you go to? The
12.
Last step?
12 again.
12
so
again.
Idea
okay.
There is now that we have stented, a stent has been fully expanded, and now it has kind of embedded into the wall of the vessel with that individual dilatation.
Excellent. Anu, there is a question which has come specifically for you. How much are you concerned about the bleeding in this elderly female? And any particular anticoagulant issue approach or what have
no,
you?
No, I mean antiplatelet, anticoagulation during the procedure, of course, we will only use, we use Angiomax, but nothing wrong in using heparin. And same thing, in this particular case, since we know she's coming electively, she was already loaded on Plavix beforehand. But otherwise, I think since LV function is normal,
that happens with the two guides, and so
I think we should just leave her on Plavix and aspirin.
Oh, okay.
Now the question comes if they had LV dysfunction. We are doing a distal unprotected left main, or in the LV dysfunction case, depending on the age. If it's young, definitely you will go to the newer antiplatelet agents. But if it's in the elderly and there's no risk of bleeding with LV dysfunction, you can think of a newer antiplatelet agent, but not in this case where her EF is normal.
Sameen, this should be very gratifying to you. I have just received an email from Dr. Nick Cruz from the Philippines, and it's 9 o'clock in the evening. 8 interventional cardiologists and fellows are watching your program in the middle of some turbulence and weather disruptions. And he's asking you a very specific question that if you do not feel extremely comfortable using rotational ablation, could you have done this case with just a high pressure balloon or cutting balloon?
Well, I would say in this particular case, that's a very good point. Knowing that what we learned after the OCT, probably this case you could do but you need not high pressure only, but then you go with the either flagstone or with angiosculpt. So you need some debulking device modification strategy.
Excellent. Nick, okay. Thank you for sending your question and continue benefiting from this webcast.
Okay, that's fine. That's okay. Leave it there. Let's go to the circumflex. This is the circ. Yeah, now show the picture last one. We'll be coming to the end also quickly. Now see that here, there's still a little.
At the inferior part of the ostium of the circ.
Circ.
Okay.
And circ is always the issue. So what we are going to do, 4.5 high pressure balloon, non-compliant into the circumflex, and then 4-0 into the LAD. And that will be within the bifurcation carina. So now in this case, we need to see, because the wire head came out, we want to make sure that it has gone through to the right
And not through the struts.
Yes. So this sometimes could become challenging. The wire a little bit, pull back the wire a little bit. Good. So, good. Get the 4-0.
Now, if the balloon had not gone, then you have to recross again.
Yeah.
Make sure that we are in the right lumen. Also, what happened? We had a run through in the circ before. Now I have the
and go negative.
Fielder. This is the 4-0 in the LED.
Yeah. Now, people also ask that one time that they were trying to go through the SKS or this V stenting and the balloon does not go, what you do? I mean, clearly that it keeps going into the one carina, one side, so you can put a balloon on other side, just low pressure. So that now that one limb of the carina is occluded, then clearly your subsequent wire will go.
So this is 4-0 in the LAD and 4-5
in
the
used one, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, part of that could be that it's a used one. You need to put a wire a little more.
Would you plan to do the OCT post-procedure?
Yeah.
I think we should do it.
All right.
Since we are done now. We are with it.
We are okay.
Good. Take a cine first. You make a both identical, no? That's good.
Go.
Okay. Let's take a picture. Good. We'll be okay. All right. So now, let's go again. One inflation will be simultaneous inflation and deflation. It's a 15 millimeter.
So that's about 12 atmosphere?
Yeah. No, but circumflex, I think we can go a little bigger.
Okay.
16. 16, yep. Yep. And no, this one actually in the LED is 16. Circumflex maybe it's a 4.5. So it's not a problem, both 16.
Now, right. if you have under expansion of any arm, this is the time what you can do again with a high pressure balloon. Go high pressure, which we are talking 18 to 20 atmosphere in one arm, which is not expanded.
Yeah.
But right now, her blood pressure actually has dropped with this inflation.
Yeah. So bring both of them at the same point first.
It's coming up.
Yeah.
So, you're the sir. Okay. You want to just open the circle a little more?
No, wait. Let the pressure come on. Can you give some neo?
This is
what I meant, that you have to wait till the blood pressure comes up.
What a wonderful teaching point. I mean, this is, we can see in the cutoff window the hemodynamics.
And also important thing is, if for some reason that the pressure has not come up despite giving neo, you may have to abort the inflation and take out both the balloons off. Now she's pacing, dropping, and that means her pressure is dropped again.
Good. Sameen,
now we are back. Yeah.
Questions coming for you fast and furious. Do you do a routine surveillance angiogram after left main stenting, or you prefer non-invasive
you
assessment?
Can go 20 now. Yeah, now actually, compared to what we used to do in the past, negative. The routine, no. In this particular case, also no. So if the very complex was additional residual vessels, go again. Now we go to 16. But routine angiography is no longer recommended. But many times we do it because there is additional lesion left. So that if in this particular case, if, with her age and everything appears good, patient clinically fine, she actually had a stressed MPI a few years ago, which was negative. I think largely because the balanced ischemia. Yeah, the balanced ischemia, take one by one.
So surveillance angiography routinely is out.
Yes.
It's an excellent question coming from Dr. Warren Arora.
Yes, Dr. Arora.
So more recently I learned that there are 25 operational OCT centers in India.
Yes. The OCT
amazing is penetration.
Yes, and particularly the word is almost out that if you are not having OCT, you cannot implant the bioabsorbable stent there.
Right. Sameen, a quick follow-up. Amongst the three aspects which I mentioned earlier, your burgeoning volumes, low complications, and appropriateness, it is the appropriateness which probably people can learn the most from, no?
Yeah, absolutely. And then
the circ probably needs a little more work.
Yeah. No, but I think we'll leave that alone. There is a little ostial dissection of the left main. You want to just see the one the IVUS?
Yeah.
I mean OCT.
Yeah.
And what are we also going to do in this particular case? She has no CV or so. So that we'll try to see whether we can give one or two boluses of integrin, not necessarily the infusion. For that type A dissection or B actually, because there is no diastasis. So this is not uncommon with a proximal vessel. This one OCT should help us also to see, but guide has to be out. I think guide is the one.
So somebody had just asked a question, which 2B3A do you prefer? You've already answered that.
We give the blood for PRU also. can just bring it up to that level. Okay.
Where? Go. Wait.
Are we ready?
Can you see?
Yep.
Good, right?
Excellent image.
Ostial circ will not expand. And I don't think we need to worry about that ostial circ now.
Are you able to see the proximal part of the left main or no? So big. Right? You have to make an angiographic assessment.
Yeah.
Oh, there you can see the double stents there. Yeah, right there, right there.
You're happy about the stent expansion?
The stents are nicely
yeah.
Proposed.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. So the question now remains about that proximal left main.
Yeah. I think we can take the wire out, no? Okay, you want to take a picture first?
Yeah, take a picture.
Something there in the cap there, but
yeah.
On the other hand, it's such a large vessel.
I think usually our principle is the 10 minutes wait
right.
In all these cases. And the 10 minutes time period will tell you whether it progresses or not progresses. If not progresses, you leave it alone. If progresses, then you
put in a stent.
Then you put a stent, yeah. Okay, now get the, we can get one bolus of integrin now. I think let's play the last one. Finish. But the rest of the lesions and all looks
they
good.
Look perfect, yeah.
So I think this, the proximal edge is this, the decision will be, now that question comes, since it's a little proximal to the edge, so it's a before the carina. So we'll try to do a, if need to be, we can just put a one short stent there. But rest of the good flow, type B dissection, the 2B3A, get left alone. So just to come back so that we finish our today's webcast, just to get our take home messages. One is the update on unprotected left main PCI and the risk of non-cardiac surgery and after stenting. That is recent data support, use of PCI in low to moderately complex unprotected left main lesions with outcomes similar to CABG, especially ostial and shaft lesions. In more complex lesions, like syntax score more than 32, CABG remains the standard choice. Also, result of the completed Excel trial will have the final answer on this issue next year. The issue about the bifurcation angle, I think very exciting, but we need to see a little more data on it, whether it will pan out in terms of prediction of the outcome. Second, the risk of non-cardiac surgery after stenting is highest in first 6 weeks period and then continues to decline over time with significant reduction after 6 months. Hence, unless really urgent, non-cardiac surgery should be deferred after 6 months post-stenting irrespective of the DES and BMS and whether you are continuing your antiplatelet therapy or not antiplatelet therapy. Then we come back to our three questions that in which syntax score group of left main disease CABG was superior to PCI at 5 years with lower MACI. Syntax score of less than 23, syntax score more than 23, and syntax score 23 to 32, syntax score 32, and all syntax score group. Second question, which unprotected left main patient will be class 3 indication as per ACC guideline for PCI? That is, isolated unprotected left main lesion with syntax score 32, unprotected left main with two vessel CAD, and synthesis score 33 and low surgical risk. Unprotected left main lesion with two vessel CAD and syntax score of 33 and high surgical risk. And unprotected left main lesion with three vessel CAD and syntax score of 22. Or unprotected left main lesion with one CTO and syntax score of 31. And we have spoken about it. And we'll change on the top that unprotected left main patient will be class 3 indication for PCI as per ACC guideline. Then lastly, recent data have suggested deferring non-cardiac surgery post-stenting for how many months to significantly reduce cardiac events? 1.5 months, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, and more than 12 months. So with that note, we bring to the conclusion. Here is very simple. Patient has a type B proximal dissection, which on the OCT, can OCT help us a little bit or no?
Same thing, I think as you're coming closer to the guide, you start seeing the dye flow, you cannot see it, plus the vessel size. This is a limitation of OCT, that if the vessel is too small, which is less than 2.5, the vessel is too large, more than 4-0, you will not be able to see the vessel, actually. And the same ostial, you know, proximal ostial, what you need is that the blood has to become to be completely replaced by the dye. So as you're coming close to the guide, close to the ostial left main, as you see that now, like you're showing, you don't see it because right now it is all flushed with the blood.
I see. Okay. Yeah. So clearly that we are going to wait about 10-15 minutes, see the proximal edge if necessary. My gut feeling is that we are going to leave it alone and we are given the 2B3A or no?
Yeah.
Given tackling bolus? Yeah. Oh, it is just arriving. Yeah. So we'll wait. For integrin bolus, and this is already about 5 minutes, will tell us whether we need to do anything or not. There is no diastasis. It still remains just a very small edge on the top, which in my opinion can be left alone.
Anu, okay. Any final message from you?
The final message, I think at this time, you know, where does OCT stand with regards to imaging in the PCI? I think in the United States, it has not made to the guidelines yet. Still, if you have questionable lesions, you have to go with FFR or IVUS. The OCT still is mostly as a part of a research tool at this time. It has made to the European guidelines, again, the 2A, in a few cases where you want to understand the reason for stent failure, and 2B, certain subset which probably where they're using BVS to understand optimizing stent implantation at this time. But like in this particular case, we just wanted to show that it is feasible with us, especially with this co-registration, where you can actually angiographic lesion and the OCT, you can see simultaneous at the same time, understand which part and what. And you, as we mentioned, with the calcium, as we saw mostly in the LAD, which is well delineated and able to see it, the plaque composition, we are able to see it better.
Anu, excellent demonstration. I hope the viewers have benefited from the numerous teaching points. I also want to thank the viewers for a very robust participation with their questions today. Please join us on session number 68 on February 17th.